Savior, Jesus Christ.
Amen.
We ask and pray that our minds focus not so much on what he did or didn't do, but who God is this morning.
Amen.
Who God is.
Yes.
Who has God been to you?
Amen.
God has been good to us.
Amen. Yes, he has.
He's worthy to be praised. It's the one time that God, in his genius, has designed, and I wouldn't miss for nothing in the world, that when the ecclesia come together, that we come before his majesty, before his grace, his throne, and he is there in presence. We are the audience, and he is the audience, and we are praising him and worshiping him with everything that we have.
Man.
God is watching us, and so as God is watching you, he ought to see somebody that's thankful that God woke you up this morning.
Amen.
That God sent you on your way this morning. That God loved you when nobody else would love you. Isn't that what I'm saying?
Amen.
And so I'm glad this morning just to be his mentor. He allows me the spiritual aptitude to look within his word and allow me to touch his word and preach his word. For I know I'm not worthy. Amen.
Amen.
And if you're honest, you know you're not worthy.
Yes.
Because God is just so good. He's good all by himself.
Amen. Amen.
So I'm glad this morning that we have this chance to share in God's word, in song, in praise. And I just know everything is going to be all right.
Amen.
I really do. I want to commend you and I want to thank you. Over the times and up the hills and valleys that we have gone through, we have kept our hand in the Master's hand. And I don't know when our season is going to come, but I got a feeling the change is going to come. Y'all say amen.
Amen.
I got a feeling God is going to do something at the U. That's our new banding name, our new luncheon name. It's the U. Mm-hmm. Y'all say amen. At the U. And we even got a symbol.
Yeah.
We got the U. There we go. Y'all can have the U. Yeah. Amen. Welcome to the U. Well, you. You are cares to be all you can be in the body of Christ through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who humbled and died for our sins. You are welcome to enjoy the Savior's invitation. At the end of this lesson, put him on in baptism. Leave out of here saved as a child of God. That's just the beginning of the work. It's then remain faithful until the last day. And then as you remain faithful, the Bible says you may not get it all right. And I don't believe we're going to get it all. Any of us are going to have it all right. But he said, you've been faithful with a few things. Come on up a little higher and I'll make you ruler over many. How many brothers, Spirit of the Lord with you?
Amen.
Amen. How many of you ready for the word of God?
Amen.
Amen. I looked through the word of God and almost three lessons God put on my heart to share with you. And it's through the Holy Spirit this morning that leads me to share this lesson with you. And I'm going to say something. You get your pen and paper out. I'm going to say something that'll help you. If you came to church, it won't be your traditional stuff. But if you came to worship, I intend to bring you into a close encounter with the Holy Spirit. A close encounter with the Holy Spirit. And so in doing so, I'd like for everyone to get your Bibles out this morning and turn to Romans chapter 7. In verse number 19, because I can't get you close to the Word of God unless you're looking at the Word of God and reading in the page of inspiration. We want to thank brethren that participated in the services this morning, especially Sean. I want to tell you, just keep praying. And you just keep trying. And you just keep doing what you're doing. God will give the increase. And we commend you for standing up and praying. And you say your prayers. The Lord lead you. And God will do wonderful things in your life. If you keep reaching out for him, God will never turn his back on someone reaching out to him.
Amen.
And all our young men, you just keep trying. I don't care what you're dealing with. You just keep reaching for the Lord. And you watch God do some explosive things in your life.
Amen.
So what you mean, getting up, praying, in service, and reading, we see you being active, we're encouraging you. We need all the help we can get. We need all our young men working in service. We need all our young ladies singing in service. You know, all the sisters and brothers coming together, an explosion for Christ. Amen?
Amen.
And I will tell you again, this is not a funeral. That is the short version of the sermon.
Amen.
There's a long version of the sermon.
Amen.
You have to tell them which one you want. Amen.
Amen.
You have to show which one you want. Amen.
Amen.
All right. So let's if you have your Bibles, can you say amen?
Amen.
Let's look at, I want to use for a text, Romans chapter 7, verse number 19. And this is a text that's used, that's been used often, very complicated text. Because of the verbiage in the text. Read along with me, if you will. The Bible says, "For the good that I would, I do not. But the evil which I would not, that I do." Isn't that something?
Yeah.
Then he says, says, now if I do that, I would not. It is no more. You're still reading with me, right? Now if I do that, I would not. It is no more I that do it, but sin that dwelleth in me. And we have long made a point of that the devil don't make you do anything. And that is not Paul's argument in the text. And so sin don't make you do anything. When we sin from our own lust. Amen. All right. And so then the text says what? I find then a law. Now that's your shouting point right there. I'm going to help you see that better. I find then a law. What? That when I would do good, evil is present with me. Why? For I delight in the law of the Lord. After the who? The inward man. To underscore that. But I see another law in my members, warring against the law of my mind and bringing me into captivity of the law of sin, which is in my members. Verse 24, O wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me from the body of death? I thank God through Jesus Christ, our Lord. So with the mind, I serve the law of God, but with the flesh, the law of sin. I want to use for a subject matter, thank God for the law.
Amen.
Thank God for the law. And thank God Paul saw another law. Mm-hmm. For he sees, he witnesses two contrasting laws. He sees first the law of sin. Then he sees the law of Christ. Uh-huh. It is incumbent to realize that as we live on this earth, that we live in a world of laws. Recognizing law by definition in this text, law means it is an inward principle or action or a force operated in a fixedness, in a regularity that is by its nature a component in which we must understand. Paul is suggesting to us that there is something on the spiritual side in the inward man that is there by law, a force that's there by law, in which we dare not take for granted, in which we dare not think we can take it on by ourselves, in which we need to consider every day of our lives.
Amen.
Why every day of our lives? He said, because every time that I would do good, evil, there's a law that's in place. What do you mean there's a law? The day that man ate of the forbidden tree, sin entered into the world and death by sin. That's a law that cannot be changed and has not been changed. You can say whatever you want to say, but when God made a decree that the day you eat of this tree, you shall surely die, that became law. And that law exists intrinsically in the mind and hearts of men. And as I stay with me now, therefore, by examination of the text, the question is then, who can be saved if there's a law in place that says that evil is always around? Not only that, Paul says that I know that in my flesh there is no good in me.
Amen.
How then can God banish me to the abyss of hell when there are laws in place that are there that insist that sin brings forth death, death and sin go together. And then the law says that every time I'm trying to do good, here comes evil running itself around. Y'all, consider this question. Because what some folk erroneously taught us is that when judgment day comes, that God, the God of heaven, the kind, merciful God, the great God of heaven, is going to somehow have us stand before him, and all the stuff that we did bad, he's going to send us to heaven. Mm-hmm. Well, now, there are some folk going to lose their soul. There are some folk that's going to go to heaven. But now, this is my position. I'm going to take this position according to the text. And I want you to hear this and hear the rest of the sermon before you go running out of here telling my brother him to preach a false doctrine. But can I say this? Can I say this? Can I teach y'all? Can I teach you?
Amen.
Can I show you something? Can I give you some of your consideration? Can I show you something? Mm-hmm. Are y'all woke this morning?
Yeah.
Everybody, if the devil got your tongue, say, let it go. Let it go. I got the shout this morning. God knew from the beginning of time that man would sin. In fact, man sinned from the beginning of time.
God, you sinning does not surprise God.
Amen.
It does not shock God that we have children out of wedlock. It does not shock God that we don't live lives like we're supposed to live lives. God, because he is God, does not judge a man because of a sin. God judges a man because of his core makeup and value system towards sin or the law of right. Y'all missing it. I'm glad that Paul said that I see the law of sin, but oh, thank God, there's another law.
Mm-hmm.
And in that law, Christ says that the law of sin brought forth death.
Uh-huh.
But I'm under direct commandment from my Father to save lives, and I have a fiduciary duty to save those that are lost.
Amen.
Y'all missed that. Yeah, that helps somebody. It maybe two people help. Let me start off. If Satan can go before God and say, according to the law, he ought to die. Because he makes himself the Son of God. If Satan can say that you ought to die because you sin, for the wages of sin is what?
Death.
All right? If Satan can say, if he can use the law to kill, God made another law to save.
Amen.
Y'all ought to say amen.
Amen.
When you're lost, it's God's legal responsibility to save those that want to be saved.
Amen.
And I don't care how folks look at you, and I don't care what folks say about you, but under the law of Christ, he's not willing that any should perish.
Amen.
Say amen.
Amen.
But all should come to truth, to come to the Lord before his everlasting return into life. It's not that he wants to say. He has to say.
Amen.
He has to say, or he'll break the law.
Yes.
But the problem is you got to want to be
saved.
And if you don't want to be saved, then you fall under the law of sin.
Amen.
The choice of being saved is not sin. The choice of being lost is not sin. The choice is rejecting the salvation that God has for each and every one of us.
Amen.
So when judgment day comes, I don't believe that if I made some mistakes along the way, God's going to burn me, and I'll burn in hell because I wasn't perfect. And I'm glad not to let you tell me I got to be perfect.
Amen.
I'm glad that when I read this text, Paul acknowledges that mankind is not perfect.
Amen.
That he is not perfect. He says that the good that I would, I don't do.
Uh-huh.
And the stuff that I hate, I've been doing it.
Yes.
How you know he's been doing it, Paul? Well, in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, around the 9th verse, the Bible said, I prayed to you over and over and over again, God. Prayed to you, and I said, help me with this thorn in my side. Now, I don't know what the thorn is, but I remember that great response from the heavens above. When Jesus declared unto him, I know that you've been praying to me. I know you've been asking me three times to help you, but my grace is sufficient for you.
Amen.
And guess what? His grace is sufficient for us this morning.
Amen.
Oh, if we don't get caught up on the outside and what we see, God is a God of the inside.
Amen.
This is what he says, for I delight in the law of God, which is after the inward man. Why not the outer man? Because by the time sin shows up on the outside, God has to go in the inside to help fix the stuff that's going wrong on the inside.
Amen.
And it's his fiduciary duty. He is bound. This is what he says in John chapter 2. Y'all look at me funny. Like I'm speaking Japanese or French this morning. I'm telling y'all ought to be shouting right now, because all the reason why you've been missing the mark is because you keep thinking that every time you sin, you just damn to hell, there's something wrong, and you spirits are messed up. But you need to understand that when you sin, you're in a position that God has to help you.
Amen.
And all you got to do is say, Lord, help me.
Uh-huh.
You have to submit to the will of God. You have to confess your sins one to another.
Yes.
And the blood of Jesus will cleanse you of all unrighteousness.
Yes.
But what's the problem of the text? Let me show you the problem of the text. What was I? I quoted something and I didn't go to it.
John
17. Watch this. I said, what did I say? My premise is that God is under direction. Christ is under direction from the Father. He's under direction. And he has a due and checking in with the Father. All right, in John chapter 17, one of our favorite scriptures to talk about the church, and it ought to be, because it's a great scripture. But John records Jesus' words. The word spake Jesus, lifted up his eyes to heaven. These words spake Jesus as he lifted his eyes up to heaven. Father, the hour is coming. Glorify thy Son. Thy Son also may glorify thee, as thou hast given him power over all the flesh, that I should give eternal life to as many as thou what? Has given me. Now watch this. He says, I have glorified thee on the earth. I have finished the work which thou givest me to do. And now, O Lord, glorify thou me in thy own self with the glory of thine. Therefore, thy work was. He goes on to say that everything that you gave me, I kept, and I haven't lost any of them that wanted to be kept. He said, Father, those that want to be saved, they're in a position to be saved. Yes. Those that want a relationship in the Father's house, I have them in my hand. For all that are yours is mine, and all mine are yours. In other words, Jesus said, your assignment that you gave me, the job, the task that you gave me to come down to a cold and cruel world, although they would sin and kill me, and while they were in the act of sinning, I still bled and died and saved every one of them that want to be saved. And you ought to shout amen. Amen. You ought to shout amen. He was on the assignment. When he says in John chapter 3, verse number 16, his assignment for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. I like this because whosoever believeth in him shall might be saved. But what do you mean it's up to me? Well, it is not the sin that will cause folk to lose their soul, but it's the makeup, the core of an individual. And let me use these three surmounting building points very quickly. It is the core and the challenge and the change in which Paul is writing about. In Romans chapter 7, look at Romans chapter 7 and verse number 22. Romans 7, I believe, verse number 19. He says, for what? The good that I would, I do not. But that which the evil that I do, that would not, that I do. What's the next verse?
Now if I do that, now if I do
every now and again, we do some stuff we know we ought not to do. Y'all ought to say amen.
Amen.
Every night we come into church and won't give God glory. You know you ought not to do that. Amen. You know you ought not to sit in the house of God and can't say thank you, Jesus, during the preached word. You ought to be able to say glory every now and again, especially when you hear how good God has been to you.
Amen.
If somebody told me that I am free from the law of sin, now that I didn't say free to sin. I'm free from the law of sin.
Amen.
But I'm not free to sin. Because under the law of sin, the only conclusion was death. But now being free from the law of sin, I live under the law of who? Christ. Are y'all with me? Are y'all with me? Can I start preaching in a minute? Everybody with me? Have I said anything false?
No.
Have I not proved anything that I said? Are we on the same page?
Yeah.
All right, so if you ever sinned before, yes, it's a bad feeling. If you ever sinned before, if you've sinned, can you raise your hand right quick? Have you sinned? Did the church make you feel like stone? Don't the church make you feel like you're worthless? Don't it make you feel like you're a second-class citizen? Don't you know when you sin, God stands up in heaven and waits for you to submit yourself to him so he can help you out that sin? Are y'all listening to me? Don't you understand that whenever you make a mistake, you don't have to wallow that mistake. You don't have to hold your hand down. Yeah. You lift your hands to Jesus and say, Lord, I'm sorry. I've sinned against you. I admit I did you wrong.
Amen.
Because God said, the curse that sin put on man's life has been null and void by the law of Christ.
Amen.
So then what do you mean? Well, the chore, the core person, has to do with one's values, has to do with one's ethics, has to do with one's thoughts, has to do with one's inner working. Because the text declares, for I delight after the Lord, after the inward man, which suggests that regardless of what we read about Paul, in Acts chapter 8 and 9, he pulled people out of the church. That he stood by and watched Philip be stoned to death and held the coat. that he brought charges against Christians, that he was on his way, even on the very day he was converted, to persecute Christians, that people were afraid of him. He breathed threatening, and he fought vigilant and hard against God, but God never killed him because God knew the core, the inner working of Paul was better than what was manifested on the outside. And I want you to know something. No matter how many mistakes I've made and how many mistakes you make, as long as the core person that's in you is still fixed on the Lord, it's going to be all right. Y'all didn't get to this. I got some good folk in here. Some of us got some bad ways, don't we? Some of us still get mad too fast. Some of us still take vengeance out on the Lord's church. Some of us still playing with God. Some of us spend our whole life just coming to church, not coming to worship, lost in traditionalism. But the core is what God looks at. I'll prove that here in just a minute. You remember David, and let's look at what Gandhi says. What Gandhi says, and he said, let me tell you something, that we ought to be careful. Your beliefs become your thoughts. Your thoughts become your words. Your words become your actions. Your actions become your habits. Your habits become your values. And your values become your destiny. Well, what do you mean, preacher? Well, the reason that I might lose my soul is because I didn't watch my thoughts. And my thoughts became my words. And my words became my actions. And my actions became my habits. And my habits became my value system. And my value system sent me on to my destiny. Amen. The core being that I am was lost in this flesh. I didn't go because I made a mistake. I lost my soul because I was lost in myself. And that's why Paul said, who shall deliver me from me?
Amen.
How's God going to help me from me? There's some stuff I've been doing since I was 8 years old. I still can't get a hold to. Y'all are saying amen. Some of y'all got some stuff y'all been doing.
Amen.
Since you was a baby. Some of y'all been bullied. Some of y'all been walking around here doing things that y'all not do. And you started this stuff a long time ago. And God's been looking at you. He's had grace and he's had mercy. He's telling you, he said, you keep living like that, you're not going to have a relationship with me. It's not that you sin. I can handle the sin, but I can handle you not submitting to me.
Amen.
I can handle you turning your nose up at me. I can handle you telling me no and him yes. I'm a jealous God. I can't stand you walking with him. I can't stand you doing his work. I can't stand you yielding to him. I need you. I want you in heaven with me. But in my Father's house, there are many mansions. That where I'm at, so I'd have told you that when I go to prepare a place for you, that where I am, you may be also. But you can't come where I am with the bad habits that you got. Y'all ought to say amen.
Amen.
Because the corporate, and you know something? There are some folk, and I say this right quick, there are some folk who sin, but the core person is a good person. There are some folk who are not in the Church of Christ that'll treat you better than folk in the church.
Amen.
There are some folk in the church all their life are mean and angry and fussy and against everything. Are you against? Yes, I'm against it. Well, you against? Yes, I'm against it. What about lip? What about you? Someone should say, are you against hate? He said, well, are you against love? He said, yes, I'm against love. And I got Bible for it. I said, what's your Bible for being against love? Ecclesiastes chapter 3, there's a time to love and a time to hate. And you know he prays. And gave book chapter and verse. When your core, and let me help you understand your core person. Because your core person is why you keep going from relationship to relationship. The reason that you're up to 5 or 6 men that you've been sexual with, or women that you've been with, because your core person who refused to submit to Christ has gotten into a habit of having the company of men than the company of God. Your core person can't stand you. You can't stand being by yourself. It messes with you when you're by yourself. You need somebody to feel good. People have become a drug for you. And you can't even drive to the store without calling 4 or 5 people saying, get in the car with me. They ain't got no gas money. They get in there, they throw paper on the floor. They sit around, they make all kind of, tear up your seats, do all kind of stuff. You still pick them up because you got to have somebody with you. Your core person is value system. Is void of the Spirit of God.
Yeah.
And Paul is saying that whenever you reach a point to where you've so foul, you'll find yourself in a world of trouble. Not because you sin, because all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Some of you sinned yesterday. Some of y'all were sinning this morning. But you know what? Because of the core person you are, you got up and came to the house of God anyway.
Man.
You walked into the door and you said, can y'all make room for this old sinner like me? Because I need to sit down. And I need to tell you, it's me, Lord, standing in the need of prayer.
Man.
It's not what we've allowed the churches to do to us. To falsely teach us that we serve a God who somehow forgets that we're human. And we serve a God that somehow forget that we're going to make mistakes. But we serve a God that's an all-knowing God.
Yeah.
He knows us better than we know ourselves.
Yes,
and aren't you glad that God don't look on the outside?
Yeah.
But boy, if he looked on the outside only, somebody be in a world of trouble.
Yeah.
If he looked on the outside, oh, all our great leaders would not have made it. He just saw that Peter cussed too much. Paul was too angry. He just saw that Thomas doubted too much. He just saw that Judas was not worth nothing. He just saw all the frailties and flaws in all of his apostles, and none of them would have made it. But God looked past the outside and saw the core being of the prayer and knew that one day he'd stand up and proclaim the word of God. Just like I believe and I'm sure today that God knows in you one day will stand up in the city of San Diego and preach and tell folk that Jesus is coming back again. And God has one church died on Calvary's cross. Got up early on the Sunday morning. He established church on the day of Pentecost. Established baptism. And those that we saved in into the watery grave of baptism.
Amen.
We know that when you're going to bring folk to Christ. But right now he's simply being patient.
Mm-hmm.
He's being patient. Not allowing the law of sin to cause him to strike down from heaven. And can you look at what happens when God is at the core of a person? Acts 13, verse number 22. After David had been in bed with Bathsheba, after David had made numerous mistakes, and Luke writes in Acts 13 and 22, I have a man or a reference point. He's the son of Jesse. What do you mean? God says.